Il est où?
Il demandait quoi? C'est lui?
Oui.
Mais c'est chez Noël. Ah, c'est lui, le ministre des Finances de Namibie. Ok, ok. Reprenez vos places, s'il vous plaît.
Good afternoon.
I'm already here.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for inviting me to the podium. I'm very honored to chair this last session of the day, which has the that's the topic on integration of the results framework, monitoring and evaluation. I'm joined by four very knowledgeable panelists, and I invite His Excellency Mr. Bahati Lukwegwo, who's the Minister of Economy and of the Democratic Republic of Congo. I have Mrs. Edith Clemens Yaka, Minister Delegate in Charge for the Budget in Burkina Faso. I have Mr. Gyan Chandra Acharya, United Nations Under Secretary General and High Representative for the Least Developed Countries, Landlocked Developing Countries and Small Island Development States. And lastly, I have Professor Emmanuel Ndozi, the Executive Secretary of the African Capacity Building Foundation. Let's give the panelists a big hand and welcome them to the stage. As I've said, the topic is integration of results, framework, monitoring and evaluation. I think it's a crucial topic that our targets must be outcome-based, they must be results-based, but they must, of course, be measurable. They must be aligned to the targets. These results must be underlined by credible data that is timely available. And then secondly, if we monitor our results and we evaluate what we have achieved, that is not an end in itself. It is, in fact, a tool that allows us to be flexible, to align and to optimize efficiency, and especially from a financial point of view, efficiency gains in resource allocation and resource utilization. I want to start with calling His Excellency Mr. Bahati Lukwegwo, the Minister of Economy for the Democratic Republic of Congo, to make his introductory statement. Minister, you have the floor.
I'll give my speech in French. Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Président, pour la parole que vous m'accordez. Je voudrais d'emblée dire que le sujet est d'une importance capitale parce que, comme vous le savez, plusieurs décisions sont prises dans nos différentes instances, mais les faiblesses sont toujours observées lorsqu'il s'agit du suivi et de l'évaluation. Et je pense que si nous voulons atteindre les résultats, réaliser les résultats que nous nous sommes assignés,
set for ourselves, then we need to place greater emphasis on monitoring and evaluation on a regular basis. And so this is the reason why this session is of great importance. Now, since we're talking about results, we're talking about monitoring and evaluation, I'd say it's easier for me to talk about what I know well, and here I refer to my country, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, as an example. And so I would like to share with you what we've already planned and what we intend to do in the Congo and how we intend to do this as we work on Agenda 2063 of the African Union. Your Excellency, the Chairperson of the African Union, the African Union Commission, that is, Your Excellency, the Vice President of Namibia, Your Excellency's ministers here present, Your Excellency's former heads of state, the different personalities here present, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to, on behalf of the Democratic Republic of the Congo, thank the organizers of this meeting and all the participants in this panel. During our work, the participants will be able to discuss Agenda 2063 and the Agenda 2030 as we consider it their implementation. Now, in this context, the results framework, monitoring and evaluation is to be considered. So Agenda 2063, I should point out, as well as Agenda 2030, provide the necessary context for a structural transformation which is sustainable for our continent, that is Africa. And exhausted programs have been drawn up based upon long drawn out consultations so as to ensure structural transformation and sustainable development. Now, the first five-year plan for implementation and the mechanisms that have been designed to implement them at every level have been considered. So this theme has specific objectives which have been given for our meeting. First of all, we need to give guidance as to how member states can apply the implementation of Agenda 2063, its 10-year implementation plan, and sustainable development. Now, the second objective is to give general guidelines on mechanisms that will enable us to develop an integrated and harmonized system so that in a coherent manner we can achieve the objectives of Agenda 2063. Now, from the experts' report, we have seen that the harmonization of the sustainable development goals for the set for the global community, as well as the African Union's 2063 Agenda 2063 for the continent, all require resources, whether financial or human resources, from all member states to be involved. And taking into account the specific aspects of our continent and the different levels, the peculiar nature of each country, it means that each country has to do their own integration process. They have to integrate the results framework into their national programs as well as their planning programs, and they need to adapt to their own context, these two agendas. And so the recommendations of the experts was that we request the African Union Commission as well as the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa to provide technical support to countries as they work towards integrating the results framework in the planning of their in their national development plans. And as was emphasized by the Prime Minister of the Democratic Republic of the Congo earlier today when he spoke, it's necessary to understand that the DRC, as far as planning is concerned, has integrated the SDGs in their design, as they design their national plans. And so they have seen the SDGs as being in line with Agenda 2063 of the Africa Union, which is working to ensure that Africa becomes a world power. That is its ambition. And so this is why the Democratic Republic of the Congo has begun designing its national strategic plan for development, which will build upon the results and the efforts that have already been made by our country. So as we try to come up to the same level as the countries that have already developed. And so the Congo, we anticipate, or we want to ensure that the Congo becomes a nation where we have a viable middle class, where we become a strong power, where our environment, industrial strength is capitalized, and we become a regional power in the end on the continent. Now, our strategic vision in the Congo is to develop so that we, and our development is based on three phases. We have the first phase from 2012 to 2020, where the DRC will become a middle-income country thanks to transformation in the agricultural sector, which is where income can be redistributed so that growth can be spread out over a larger section of the population. Now, the second phase, 2020 to 2030, the DRC wants to move towards becoming an emerging country where its economy has been transformed and become a strong industrialized economy, strength in the energy sector, developing its mining and agricultural sectors. Now the third, from 2030 to 2050, we want to see our country growing and becoming an innovative economy based on innovation. Now, as we're moving towards becoming an emerging economy, we have coincided our development plans with that of the Agenda 2063 of the African Union. And the development plan that we have established in our country is also in line with the SDG implementation phases to ensure that we reach our goal of ensuring that the Democratic Republic of the Congo becomes an emerging economy. So our plan, therefore, is an implementation tool so that we become a developed economy, and we have a short-term, medium, and long-term plan. In the Prime Minister's statement this morning, he had said that on the 3rd of April 2016, we were sharing the macroeconomic development plan, and we have seen the preliminary results showing that we have a 7.4% per year growth from 2014. We have seen 9.5% in 2014. And so this growth in our economy, we have seen thanks to stability in the economy and a favorable environment on the global market. This was higher than that of the sub-Saharan region, and we anticipate that we will build upon this growth so that over the next 10 years it will be stronger despite the decreasing prices of commodities due to the increase in exports of other countries and the food prices, as well as the supply and demand issues linked to the agricultural sector, the agro-industrial sector also coming into play here. So the approach that the DRC is taking is one of integration. With we want to integrate our national plans with the two agendas, as I said, and obviously we would need to ensure that M&E takes place in the same way as it is planned for in Agenda 2063 and Agenda 2030. Now, if we're talking about it becoming an emerging economy and industrial development, overall structural development, well, we would need funding to finance these developments, not only for our infrastructural development, but to train our human resources to ensure that they can participate in achieving these programs. The objective is to generate wealth and employment for our young Africans, who represent by 2030 a large part of the global middle class. So I would like to end on an optimistic note by highlighting that if Africa accelerates the implementation of the measures for free movement of goods and people in the regional and sub-regional integration programs, then Africa will create the necessary environment for strengthening and building its unity and to do away with the numerous conflicts that are harming the continent's stability. This is a prerequisite for the rapid achievement or realization of Agenda 2063 and the Sustainable Development Goals, or Agenda 2030. So the improvement of the macroeconomic environment will enable us to take advantage of foreign capital and build on domestic savings, and which is necessary for investment to take place. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Honourable Minister. I think you did very well in keeping in the 15 minutes that each speaker has. Thank you very much for your interesting intervention that showed us how DRC is trying to integrate its national plans domestically, regionally, and globally. The next panelist on my list is sitting to the left of me, and it's Mrs. Edith Clemens-Yaka, Minister Delegate in charge of the budget of Burkina Faso. Madam, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished ministers, distinguished delegates. At the outset, I should like to thank the UNECA and the African Union Commission for the invitation granted to us to participate in this panel relating to the integration of the results framework, monitoring and evaluation. I should like to thank the various speakers who have spoken before me for their contributions, which have been extremely interesting. As you are aware, African countries are facing a dual transition, a transition at the global scale between the MDGs and the 2030 Development Programme, the SDGs, as well as a transition at the regional level with Agenda 2063. Thus, relevant questions relating to harmonization of frameworks and the creation of common joint mechanisms for implementation for monitoring and evaluation in the implementation of Africa's joint objectives for sustainable development and transformation are problems which are of current interest. A common development framework for Africa can be a true motor for sustainable growth, which would also have the benefit of favoring and being beneficial to less well-off populations. To achieve the sustainable development goals calls for synergies in action. Indeed, success in the implementation of this new agenda, the post-2015 and the 2063 agenda in our countries, beyond its integration in our various public policies by means of our sectoral policies, this will call for commitment and involvement of all stakeholders at the national level. For example, governments, public and private administrations, civil society, NGOs, technical and financial partners, and of course, grassroots populations. Unlike the MDGs, which counted more on international solidarity for implementation, SDGs and Agenda 2063 focus more on mobilization of public and private own resources. This involves a greater degree of commitment by our states, which will have to develop new strategies better to mobilize internal domestic resources as well as external resources. For my country, Burkina Faso, the context in which it finds itself is favorable to the extent that we are in the process of preparing the National Economic and Social Development Plan. You know that we have, since the end of 2014, we've had a quite special time, and in 2015 we had elections which brought in a new president and government. So for the implementation of the program of the new government, this is something which is in the process of being prepared, and we've called it the National Social and Economic Development Program. The process is underway and is making it possible to set up an institutional mechanism which is basically made up of a technical committee and a drafting committee which will give rise to the accelerated growth strategy for sustainable development which we concluded in 2015. And we have to have a second stage of this. So with the coming in of the SDGs and Agenda 2063, as well as the new government coming in, we're now setting up the program. And even before we do this, which is work which should be done before the end of the first 6 months of 2016, we're hoping to have a round table to bring in the technical and financial partners. And from all of the work we've done, we've extracted and drawn a certain number of measures which we have regarded to be urgent in the water sector, in health, and in education. Here, we're already implementing these through our budget, our 2016 budget, and we have proceeded to mobilize own resources to a greater extent because we have implemented a certain number of reforms from the fiscal and customs point of view in order to help us in the implementation of our objectives. So, for the technical committee, it was we established an SDG committee, the aim of which was to internalize international commitments in our national development program. This committee, together with technical and financial partners identified, is working on the prioritization of the SDGs and the international Francophone organization is also helping us. This tool will make it possible for us to select the SDGs in accordance with Burkina Faso's priorities. This prioritization will make it possible to give the appropriate context in our development plan. Amongst the activities we're carrying out, there is also a meeting on the definition of roadmaps for SDGs to make it possible to more smoothly implement them in our country and also to prioritize them. We should also note that we're in the process of holding consultations with a view to ensuring the covering in the National Development Plan of elements relating to Agenda 2063. To do this, there has been we've tried to draw up a table showing the correspondences between the Agenda 2063 and the SDGs. Given that the SDGs are integrated into Agenda 2063, it would probably be better to set up a monitoring and evaluation framework, just one, a single one, in order to implement the framework. It is vital for states to have a good and to share an understanding of the situation. The two programs can only be conducted if information campaigns and public awareness-raising activities are undertaken to make better known the interests that both programs represent for national development and the role which each actor can play in achieving the results. With this in mind, the 2030 program has to be interpreted as an attempt to deal with the global aspects of development challenges for Africa, whereas 2063 should be considered as a response to the problems of development specific to the continent and its specific aspirations. The global and continental aspects come together and share elements to a large extent. The existence of Synergia increases the possibility of implementing the two initiatives without having too many frameworks for decision makers. It also reduces certain coordination problems encountered in the implementation and monitoring of the two programs. Thus, the mechanism foreseen by Burkina Faso is a framework, a harmonized monitoring framework, which will make it possible both to have monitoring and evaluation of the National Economic and Social Development Program of Agenda 2063 and of the post-2015 agenda. To achieve this objective of harmonization of the framework for monitoring and development for sustainable development up to 2030 and Agenda 2063 and the National Development Plan, we will have to have a roadmap which is clear and which has been prepared with clear deadlines and responsibilities for the framework of a results framework and for a single system for monitoring and evaluation. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, before we go back to specific items relating to this question, this is the contribution which my delegation wished to make in the framework of our interactive debates on the integration of the results framework, monitoring and evaluation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yaka. I think we heard a excellent contribution of how Burkina Faso tries to integrate its development planning process into regional and global efforts, and how a common development framework could benefit us if it is properly prioritized, if funding is sustainable and if there's a good balance between the social and the productive sectors. I think I agree we will look forward to an in-depth discussion during the second phase of this session. Let me now ask Mr. Gyan Chandra Acharya, the United Nations Under Secretary General and High Representative for the Least Development Countries, Landlocked Developing Countries and Small Island Developing States for his intervention. Again, 15 minutes and
thank you, Chair. Thank you very much. I would like to begin by thanking UNECA and AUC for organizing this very important meeting and very important topic, integration of the results, framework, monitoring, and evaluation. I think it is very clear that we heard in the morning by, from Madam Zuma, AUC Chair, as well as many of the ministers, that there is almost a 90% congruence between the 2030 agenda and the 2063 agenda. That clearly speaks for itself that there is a need for integration of the results framework, monitoring, and evaluation. Now, when we look at, of course, the domestication of that, and then look at the capacity of the countries that we are talking about, I think there is simply no alternative to ensure effective implementation of these development agendas in this region. We have to have an integrated results framework as well as monitoring and evaluation. And again, when you look at the results, the aim of eradicating poverty, promoting sustainable development through structural transformation also requires integrated approach to all of that. And so that there is no need to really, really stress more why it is required. Now, talking about this coherent framework of evaluation and monitoring at the result framework, we believe that this will assist in tracking progress, directing resources, and making institutional arrangements nimble. It will help identify achievements and also challenges during implementation of the programs and support decision makers in making policy decisions and priority settings. Above all, we believe that in view of the very lofty goals that we have, if we want to achieve the goals early on, integrated approach is really critical. In order to undertake efficient and effective monitoring and evaluation, and we have heard the coherence of all the indicators where there is a congruence is critical, and when there is an additionality, of course, there will be a separate indicators for those areas where there is an additionality. I would also like to stress here that when you look at the indicators, regularly collecting data on indicators and analysis of the results on the ground will help us use the right management tool to help countries better align implementation strategies on the ground, as I said, and of course allocate resources accordingly. It is also important that we improve our methodologies to make them comparable, collect reliable, timely, and quality data as much disaggregated as possible on a regular basis, because a lot of monitoring work depends on it. New technology also provides us with new tools and a scope to get metadata and other analytics. I think those are some of the tools that we can also really look at in terms of making best use of the data that we have available. Now, when you look at the capacity of the countries, I think I represent, in terms of the advocacy, the countries which have the least capacity and the huge challenges. Just to give you a flavor of the countries of the least developed, landlocked, and the small islands, in Africa, out of the 48 least developed countries, we have two-thirds of the least developed countries in Africa. Out of the 32 landlocked developing countries, we have half of them in Africa, and there are a number of small island developing states in Africa. Therefore, when you look at the capacity constraints, and then of course look at the challenges, the multiple challenges that they face, we really see that there is a need for an integrated approach, not only between 2030 agenda and 2063 agenda, but also vary their specific program of action that these countries, you know, at the United Nations, we have come out with. For the least developed countries, there is a Istanbul program of action, which primary objective is to enhance structural transformation, build productive capacity, and build resilience. They are very much in line with what you have been talking about, 2063. Again, looking at the landlocked developing countries, we have a Vienna program of action, which gives a lot of emphasis on infrastructure, again, emphasis on the transit facilitation, trade facilitation, and regional integration. And by the way, the regional integration is not that much really articulated in the 2030 agenda. So, and then you have a very high level of prioritization of the regional integration agenda here. So we see that there is just so much of a similarity. Again, when you look at the small islands, the ocean agenda has got a very high priority in the Samoa pathway, which is the specific program of action that was agreed for the small island developing state. And we're all working with the national level authorities to implement that on the ground. So when we say integration, I'm sure that we look at that at the national level, integration of all the global frameworks. And when we say that, of course, 2020 means that, of course, Addis Ababa Action Agenda, Climate Change Paris Agreement is part of the global development framework. So we do hope that when we talk about all of that, we really take a holistic approach to the implementation on the ground. Now, the national level ownership and enhanced capacity is very important. As we said, we talked about data. The strengthening of national capacity for data collection and administration is needed in order to take data both more accurate and up-to-date, and we have had a lot of discussions on that earlier, and we are really commending the African Statistical Institute and the Training Institute, the work, the resource mobilization efforts, and your allocation commitment to allocate 0.0115% of the budget, and technical assistance from the international organization and others will be really critical in ensuring better data and statistics. And we are really giving a lot of emphasis on the partnership for data, which will be a critical element of course, the monitoring and evaluation on the ground. Again, I would also like to stress here that there has to be a very strong correlationship between the national level review and reporting and the continental or the regional level and sub-regional level monitoring and evaluation and reporting. I think what we have really seen very useful in terms of our own work with the LDCs, LLDCs and SIDS is that when you have a regional level, the monitoring and evaluation, you really get to see the best practices on the ground, you really get to see what are the lessons learned, what are the really scalability that we can really get it in terms of really use them in other countries, in other contexts as well. So we believe that in order for enhancing those best practices, sub-regional level as well as continental level regional evaluation and the reporting mechanism should be further strengthened. And I would also like to say that a need for a little bit more disaggregated data will be really very useful, especially when you look at the LDCs, LLDCs, and small island developing states. And finally, at the global level, it is equally important that Africa region shares its progress report at the global level. Global monitoring helps us make the global partnerships also more accountable and impact-oriented. In a globalized and highly integrated world of today, multi-stakeholder global partnerships are essential, and a conducive global environment is critical for making progress at the community, national, and regional level. And we all know that HLPF, FFD, and the DCF mechanism should be fully utilized by the African countries to make sure that we have a proper global monitoring and evaluation, and there is an accountability at the global level in terms of not only financing, but all resources, including technology, capacity building, and of course the enhancement of the integration at the global in terms of the global policy making. I would just like to say finally that in terms of the UN system, there is a mainstreaming acceleration and policy support program which is being developed by the United Nations Development Group, which is an idea to really get a more integrated manner, provide support to the countries on the ground, which is being worked out among the UN development systems, and I'm sure that that will also help at the national level to have a better integration of the 2030 agenda together with your own national development plans, as well as the 2063 agenda of the region as a whole. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you very much, Mr. Anchaida. The last panelist that will enlighten us is Professor Emmanuel Nadozi, the Executive Secretary of African Capacity Building Foundation. We are looking forward to your intervention. Professor, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Let me join the other distinguished panelists in thanking the African Union leadership, as well as the UN Economic Commission for Africa's leadership, for giving me the opportunity to make a presentation on this very important issue today. And I do recognize the ministers, honorable ministers here present, as well as heads of delegations, heads of UN agencies, the commissioners, as well as the diplomatic corps. Mr. Chair, I think for once, as someone who has been involved in this process right from the get-go in both processes. I'm very delighted to see that we finally can be discussing the two agendas in a way that is no longer to talk about how we are going to prepare them, but rather how we can deliver on them. Because for once, Africa came well prepared in its engagement with the rest of the world. This is a very significant departure from the past, where instead of having a consultative and bottom-up approach in developing an agenda, we had this time around, instead of having a top-down approach, we actually had a bottom-up and consultative approach. And also, instead of going to negotiate from a position of weakness, Africa for once went and negotiated with the rest of the world from a position of strength. And Africa also even had a common position. So this is very, very important for noting as far as the continent is concerned. Now, to specifically give you a bit more insight on the issue at hand, which is how we can properly integrate the resource framework as well as the monitoring and evaluation frameworks in the implementation of Agenda 2063 and the Sustainable Development Goals. To do this, I will ask four questions, and I will also try to answer those four questions. The first one is, that comes to mind naturally, is why do we need to integrate the monitoring and evaluation framework and the resource framework? Why integrate? The second question is it actually possible to integrate? So you like to integrate, but is it realistic and possible to do so? The third question is, how do we go about integrating, or how are we integrating the resource framework and the monitoring evaluation framework? And last but not the least is, who should do what and who is doing what? Let me begin with the first question, why integrate? This issue has been thoroughly, more than adequately dealt with by the preceding panelists this morning and this afternoon. And in fact, you, Under Secretary General Acharya, just gave a very strong and eloquent argument in support of integrating the resource framework as well as the monitoring and evaluation mechanisms. So I will not dwell too much on that, but I will only say that succeeding in achieving both agendas would definitely require a coherent approach. And also, if we have an integrated implementation strategy, then we must integrate the monitoring and evaluation framework and resource framework. Now, let me move quickly to question number two, which is it possible to integrate? Indeed, the answer I have here is yes, it is possible to integrate. Why do I say so? Well, it's simple. All the 17 SDGs are embedded in and contained in Agenda 2063. So the integration is going to be easier than we envisaged. And as someone who worked on this, we kept our eyes on both things, making sure that they were not too divergent. Also, the Agenda 2063 could serve as a vessel to deliver on the Sustainable Development Goals. Because if you look at it very carefully, you'll see that the 17 SDGs are more or less a subset of the 20 goals of the Agenda 2063's first 10-year implementation plan. Because the 17 goals deal with economic plus social plus sustainability in the SDGs. But in the 20 first 10-year implementation plan of the Agenda 2063 deals with economic, social, and sustainability issues as well. But in addition, brings in issues related that are political and cultural in nature, and as was observed as well, issues that are pertinent for the continent, such as regional integration. And so, for me, therefore, it is possible to integrate the resource framework as well as monitoring and evaluation. And question number three, which is how do we actually integrate? There are several things that you have to do in trying to integrate the resource framework, or even to integrate the monitoring and evaluation mechanisms and processes. But the most important thing, in my view, is you have to adopt a credible integration approach. And I'm happy to say that that has been done as we speak. But when you adopt a credible integration approach, do you stop there? The answer is no. You've got to look at other things. First thing is we have to analyze the contents of both agendas very carefully and very methodically so that we can see specifically how this integration can take place in reality. Secondly, we have to also embed and assimilate these agendas, or the other way around, the regional economic communities and national strategic plans and frameworks and action plans in a sort of a domestication process that is necessary. This is because if they're all going to be leading into either the SDGs or the Agenda 2063, then the process of bringing about coherence and bringing about domestication at the national level and at the regional level becomes extremely important. So the embeddedness is extremely important. Thirdly, we also need to really then establish an M&E, or monitoring evaluation framework and mechanism, that really accommodates or caters to both agendas. This is what you have to do in order to really properly integrate. Fourthly, you have to then begin to think about compiling and issuing, or how you're going to report, and in which case, therefore, to really properly integrate, you have to compile and issue a single periodic performance report, which will go towards final reports as you monitor and evaluate those processes. Last but not the least, therefore, is to think about establishing the channels of accountability, because the accountability architecture is as important as the results that you want to get in this process. So for me, I think these are things that are critical for having a proper integration of the resource framework as well as the monitoring evaluation mechanisms. And this is precisely what, under the leadership of the African Union, is ongoing and has actually happened. So more specifically, we will see that the channels of accountability has been established. And already we have the organizations that are involved there. There's a technical team comprising of the African Union Commission, supported by the NEPAD Planning and Coordinating Agency, the UN Economic Commission for Africa, the African Development Bank, and the African Capacity Building Foundation, and statisticians. And this is really the place where we will compile and produce performance progress reports using the information from member states and the RECs. So I think if you can keep in mind that therefore the issue of data and statistics becomes critical, you know, for you to be able to accomplish this task. Also, technical teams will report to the coordination meeting of the chief executives of the African Union Commission, the regional economic communities, the NEPAD Planning and Coordinating Agency, UN Economic Commission for Africa, the African Development Bank, and the African Capacity Building Foundation, which meets every 6 months. And this is the technical steering committee that will be overseeing this. Another thing is there's a coordination meeting also that will report to the Agenda 2063 Ministerial Follow-Up Committee. And the Ministerial Follow-Up Committee will feed into the AU Executive Council, which ultimately reports to the AU summit. So the accountability architecture is something that is really now thought about, and we'll start to get it underway and implement it so that it can help this properly integrate the resource framework and monitoring evaluation for both agendas. So accountability architecture already exists, but it is already in place. So, and it will really encapsulate all the SDGs, and the domestication exercise is ongoing in 23 countries as we speak, and the implementation of the Agenda 2063 is also ongoing through national and regional economic plans and regional initiatives in about 12 countries, where we're really tracking the 12 flagship projects of the first 10-year plan of Agenda 2063. So having seen that, therefore, what we need to do there is ask ourselves, this looks good and fine, but is it going to really happen if we don't do certain things? The answer is no. There are critical issues that have to be taken care of. And I think these have been identified by numerous presenters and panelists from this morning. I can say three critical ones. One is money, and two is capacity, and three is coordination. Because from the point of view of the African Capacity Building Foundation, and I'm glad that Under Secretary General Acharya really hammered on this, especially with the least developed countries where Africa has the dominant number, the capacity issue is so significant that we need to pay special attention to it overall in implementing the SDGs and implementing Agenda 2063, but more specifically, the capacity for monitoring and evaluation and for data collection so that the statisticians that we need will have them, and we have the statistical agencies and departments functioning at full level. But developing, retaining, and utilizing the expertise needed is what is important. So developing the expertise is not enough. We must retain them. We must also utilize them fully. And we need to also create and strengthen the institutions that will play the key role in monitoring and evaluation at the national, at the regional, at the continental levels. And for 25 years, the African Capacity Building Foundation, which turned 25 this year, has done this and will continue to support the countries, the regional economic communities, and the continental organizations in building the capacity necessary, not just for integrating the monitoring framework, but also in monitoring and evaluating the results that are coming from the SDGs and Agenda 2063. Thank you very much. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much, Professor. We have heard the four interventions from the panelists, and in as much as I don't want to summarize each one of them, I have a list of buzzwords that I picked up out of the interventions of these four panelists, which I want to share with you before we open the floor for the general discussion. I heard that results must be measurable, compatible, and timely available. Results must become part of a planning process, whether that is nationally, regionally, or globally. We must build on our achievements, share experiences of success, but also share mistakes and avoid them. We have to deploy sector-specific approaches, which will probably result in optimal utilization of resources. Time frames for development plans should be ambitious, but should remain realistic. Integration must happen domestically, regionally, continentally, and globally. And that brings about a need for free movements of goods, services, and people on the continent. We have to develop a common development framework and a common development framework, especially the funding thereof, should move away from the approach of yesteryear where we were relying on development aid. It must now shift away from that and concentrate on domestication of public resources, but also better utilization of private sector resources. We must have a balance between the social and productive sectors in our approach, and the necessary and required prioritization of development goals must happen in a common framework. We have heard that Agenda 2030 and 2063 are very compatible. They are covering similar issues. They are not contradictory. Therefore, a common development framework and evaluation framework is very possible. But it must be an integrated approach. It is crucial that we integrate to make sure that early harvests are happening, because early successes are needed to keep the momentum. To achieve that, we must institutionalize the integrated approach.
We must develop the necessary managerial skills and capacities, but we must also develop data collection and data processing capacities so that we can evaluate properly. Again, we have to evaluate not only our national processes and achievements, but also regionally and globally, so that we can peg ourselves at all levels and see where we have to do better. It is possible to deliver both these agendas at the same time, but there is some additional work to be done to unbundle the different aspects in each of these agendas. There is a lot of detailed work to be done to do and develop the necessary strategies and action plans, which then must be embedded in the evaluation process. Reporting standards and procedures should equally be harmonized and streamlined. Then accountability and integrity of the reporting and evaluation process may not be compromised. And lastly, the integration and evaluation framework and its whole program must be adequately resourced, both from a material and an human capacity point of view. Those are among the buzzwords that I heard. I hope they help to generate a discussion that will now follow. We have an hour to do that, and I open the floor for discussion. Is it Senegal? You have the floor.
Thank you very much. I will still speak in English. I want to raise three needs. The first need is a need, as mentioned by our colleague from SBF, Emmanuel Ndadonzi, a Pan-African harmonized framework for the development indicator. This subject was discussed many years ago. As mentioned by Benin earlier, in fact, I'm sure that we have more similarities than differences between African countries. Myself, I have worked in many African countries for the development plan. 80% of the indicators could be the same indicator. Maybe the value will be different, but the set of indicator, 80% could be the same. So I think this integrated framework would be very useful for national development plans. Number two, we need selectivity and gradual monitoring of development indicator. I don't think the SDG, we need more than 40 indicators because we have 17 goals if we don't take care of the number of goals, we can have 100 indicators. I don't think this is a solution. We should have not more than 40 indicators for the SDG. The second level is the regional level. We have this Agenda 63, we have African position. I will add 20 more, African specific. For example, the SDG can talk about primary education. Maybe this is very important, but technical education could be a key for the regional level. The sub-regional level, for example, we have ECOWAS. We can add also some indicators. And the country, finally. So it will be like a pyramid. The base will be the SDG, and at the top you will have the national, and you will have everything. Number three, we need to develop synthetic indexes to better capture the progresses made by African countries. Because the problem with the MDGs, you cannot exactly in one phrase or one sentence tell to a country that you are progressing. If you have a synthetic index, you can capture the incremental improvement year by year. So this is my final proposal. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your insights. I think you could have just been a panelist here.
Thank you. South Africa, you have the floor.
Senegal will be a difficult act to follow because he has been contributing very much in structuring the development indicators. He has a report that he compiled that makes a lot of sense. And I think a common framework is necessary. The indicators, of course, have to be, because the data as collected may not be collected on the same standard, so you have to have post-facto harmonization and ex-ante harmonization, which basically is a very tricky process for statistics. We need to bear that in mind. But harmonization prior is the most critical, and the provision of metadata for those indices or indicators that we are basing or measuring our progress against. But what is important, Chair, is to really realize, and I think Mohamed Senegal, the work that they did is very crucial in terms of designing this architecture. Because the discussions as we went into these indicators and goals, particularly indicators, it was a negotiation that was almost saying, bargain and say, give my indicator one or two indicators, give my goal or target two indicators or one indicator. It doesn't make sense in terms of the architecture. There's still a lot that has to be done to try and build a systematic pyramid of hierarchy of indicators. Because in the end, probably we need only 20 or so indicators that we can remember that actually relate to this entire pyramid. And I think there is need to focus on those processes of understanding what are the common things that relate to this particular target or goal. And having done that, I think we would have really eased the processes by which this common framework can be achieved. To do that, Chair, will require obviously resources. I mean, the first reaction of countries to the work of statisticians has been captured, and many UN countries saying, well, these indicators are not so appropriate for my country and so on. We as statisticians expected that, because amongst ourselves, as we consulted on this, we could see those reactions coming up. And it would have been foolhardy to imagine that the indicators will be cast in stone. Quite clearly, it's going to be a learning exercise as we go forward, although the goals are not to be reopened and the targets probably not to be reopened. But as far as the indicators are concerned, I think it's a process of science and learning. And we have to give space for that pyramid of needs. Because if you recall, the Secretary General pointed out to five things: leave no one behind, focus on justice, make the economy transformative, those five things. Obviously, we want high-level indicators that could talk to those five things. And all those five things go into these goals as well as the targets. And therefore, the indicators equally will have to be allowed to play that kind of role. So, Chair, my input would be, as statisticians, we'll need a bit of time to get that framework that is a pyramid, that architecture to be working. It will take a bit of time, but at least the 302 indicators are a start. I thank you.
Thank you very much, South Africa. Yes, I think it's true. And we heard it from one of our panelists. It's important, what is it that we want to measure? How do we measure it? But then also, how do we report on it? Now, there's a lot of work to be done at technical level to achieve a harmonized and integrated approach. Benin, you have the floor.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je voudrais apporter également une contribution sous forme de proposition. Vu la complexité, d'abord le nombre et la complexité donc des indicateurs qui doivent couvrir tous les domaines du développement, je voudrais suggérer que une masse critique de cadres de diverses compétences soient formées au niveau donc de chacun des pays. Donc autrement dit, ils
sont trained so that they can head their sectors. I think we need to integrate this notion of harmonization through training. We need to provide training of we need to provide skills. We need to have high-level people, well-trained in different countries, who will be able to support their countries to be able to ensure that the different disciplines have appropriate skills. Because you know that there are priority sectors, for example, health, which was mentioned earlier. There's also infrastructure, different types of infrastructure, whether energy or transport, etc. And so we need to have the appropriate skills. The statisticians that we have available are not sufficient in all of our countries. There are some countries where these skills are at a crucial level, and or rather a very few statisticians in some countries. So I think what is needed is that we need the relevant skills, trained people, to be able to address these indicators in the right way so that they can provide support to their countries as we monitor and evaluate Agenda 2063's implementation as well as Agenda 2030. So we need a critical mass so that each country can indeed address this challenge of integration of the results framework and to ensure that we have a synergy as we develop our continent. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I turn to my panelists on their take on these three comments? The first comment, if I can offer, is from Senegal, which made us very much aware about the additional work that needs to be done to develop that pyramid that talks to what indices would measure what and bring that into relation with the targets. A similar complementary comment was made by South Africa, which reiterated the need to do some technical work on the statistical side so that we harmonize what we collect in data, how we report on it, and that is standardized. And then Benin made a comment on the need to develop a critical mass of expertise so that we are meaningful in our data collection and analysis from the beginning. Any one of the panelists that wants to react on that? Honourable Minister, you have the floor.
Thank you, Excellency, the Ministers of Finance and the Chair of the Panel of Namibia, the Minister from Namibia, thank you. I would like to thank all the panelists who have spoken because they have enriched the debate, or rather those who have spoken from the floor have contributed and enriched what we shared. And there is a methodology that has been proposed that we need to follow. How we go about implementation and concrete proposals have been made as far as taking into consideration statisticians, but also training high-level skills in the different sectors. So I don't really think that there's any specific question that I need to respond to at this point, but I am emphasizing that we need to integrate all the points that have been relevant, integrate this so that in all of our countries we can implement what has been proposed in a practical manner. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I would like to also thank the distinguished delegates for their comments. I think they are very important. We remember very well that when there was a discussion on the indicators as well as even the targets, a lot of times member states were trying to struggle, including the institutions, including the United Nations and others. How do really we make those global goals and targets relevant to the national and regional specificities? You know, when you look at the regional and the national level circumstances, are all these global goals and the targets really relevant? So there is really, when it was being discussed, there, a lot of time we had a discussion on that, and you rightly said, as South Africa just mentioned, that yes, the Secretary General was really trying to look at 5 P's, people, peace, progress, planet, and partnerships, and then really look at the goals in a way that gives a little bit of a coherence and a little bit of architecture as well. I think that was really made an effort. But again, when we look at all of that, we fully understand, as Senegal said, that some harmonization is really critical, and we really have to really make sure that there is a gradualism in it, so that when we get the indicators on the ground, look at the scientific basis of that, and then the implementation and implementability of that, I think all these has to be relevant at the national level. Otherwise, this just become a burdensome exercise and very difficult to really implement. The other thing, which is also very important for all of us, so just to remember ourselves, is that when you look at the indicators, I think we have heard a lot of times among the districts and in the statisticians that people were looking at, experts were looking at the methodology and data, and in some cases we have both methodologies agreed and data also available. In some cases you have methodology agreed but data not available, and in some cases you don't have even methodology agreed and no data available. So you had a huge discussion on those parameters in preparation of the indicators. So this is a learning exercise, but definitely. But I think one of the things that we really have to remember is that how do we really make the indicators at the end of the day and the monitoring process transformative, integrated, and of course, leaving no one behind as a fundamental principle is something that we should be really keeping in mind all the time, and they are really critical. And this is the paradigm shift that we are seeking in terms of the national development efforts. So I think that's the parameter in which we should be all looking at the indicators. Thank you.
Thank you. Hold your comments, please. I have two flags up, so you can, when I give you the floor, then integrate it. I have Tanzania and Tunisia. I'll start with the Honourable Deputy Minister of Tanzania. The answer was given already. Thank you very much. Then I go to Tunisia.
Thank you, Chair. I thank you, dear delegates. I'm taking the floor. I think we all do agree with the principle of the setting up how to integrate the monitoring and the evaluation that Tunisia has already adopted Agenda 2030 and the SDGs, which should cover the period, you know, 2017-2020. We have adopted the objectives, and we've done tremendous work with the objectives. May I draw your attention to the setting up of benchmarks, because one of the speakers, summary indicator, benchmark. Let me talk about our experience of regional development, and this is within Tunisia. So it's an ideal, which is a composite benchmark, which deals with a theme of the population, health, education, knowledge. It's a composite benchmark which deals with the in Tunisia. So we might transpose this experience to the continental level, and so that we can have a benchmark of a comparability between among African countries and assess the progress made towards the achievement of the SDGs and Agenda 2063. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. You see, those are all these different nuances, whether it's a benchmark or an indicator or a measure, or that needs to be harmonized, that we talk about the same things. But I think the principal point is of course, taken. If I have no flag up, I will ask the professor to react. You have the floor.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Chair. I think the comments from South Africa and Senegal are quite pertinent, and I usually do not disagree with either Honorable Mubarak Lo or Honorable Fali, because they are all very smart, very wise people, and their points, especially when it comes to issues relating to statistics or issues relating to indicators and indices. So I think the points are very important for us to take, to especially in moving forward. To see that you, even though rightly pointed out, that the goals and the targets may not be renegotiable, but as far as the indicators are concerned, you can still have the indicators you have, but you can still have some kind of synthesized indicators or indicative indicators that are of a higher level that will help to create this kind of pyramidal indicators reporting that you mentioned. So this is something that seriously we have to look into, working with all of you, and see how we can benefit with your experience on that. Donc, pour répondre aux questions, à la question qui a été posée par l'honorable représentant du Bénin, je pense que c'était une question très importante. Car nous avons déjà, en tant que la Fondation pour le renforcement des capacités en Afrique, la CBF, nous avons déjà entrepris un travail très énorme, n'est-ce pas, pour évaluer les capacités nécessaires pour la réalisation de l'agenda 2063 au niveau continental et au niveau régional. Et nous avons déjà fait ce travail. Mais nous n'avons pas encore fait le travail au niveau national. Car c'est ça la première étape pour, n'est-ce pas, comprendre quels sont les besoins pour réaliser non seulement les objectifs de développement, mais aussi, surtout, dans le domaine de suivi et évaluation, pour pouvoir donc entreprendre ou développer une stratégie pour le renforcement des capacités et mettre en œuvre des plans spécifiques et aussi faire en sorte que il y a la mise en œuvre de ces plans. Mais il est très important de savoir que pour réaliser tous ces buts, il faudra que nous continuions de bénéficier du soutien, n'est-ce pas, des bailleurs de fonds et de notre institution financière, car il nous faut des ressources que nous pouvons utiliser pour faire ce travail. Nous avons, non seulement la CBF, mais aussi d'autres organisations qui font le même travail. Donc, mais nous avons besoin d'avoir le soutien de tout le monde pour pouvoir continuer à faire cela, et nous sommes prêts à venir aider les pays, chaque pays qui ont besoin de renforcer leurs capacités, qu'ils soient au niveau de suivi et évaluation ou bien dans d'autres domaines. Merci.
Thank you. My last panelist who has a chance now to react to all the questions that have been given, Madame Jacob.
Merci bien, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Chair. It will only be a repetition, because I would simply say that we take note of the contributions of various countries which I took the floor after our presentation, and I would like to underscore the contribution from our colleague from Benin, and the response provided, you know, by my colleague, the colleague on my left, because there's an issue of
capacity building is very, very important. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Sure, we have some minutes left. You
can take the floor again.
Just to also touch upon the capacity building raised by Bena. I think it is very important issue. This is in fact one of the fundamental issues that we have been raising at the global level to make sure that when we embark on new commitments, there has to be a very strong global commitment to support countries to build their capacity. And I fully agree that the training is very important. The skill development is very important, but across the sector. I think this is completely a new approach that we are developing, and there is a need for a national level, regional level, even I would say global level capacity enhancement in order to really implement it on the ground. So I just wanted to stress that this is one of the fundamental issues we are looking at it.
Thank you very much. It looks as if we have exhausted this very important topic. And I think before we want to close, as in concluding remark, I think it is very heartening and very encouraging to see that we are now taking the first concrete steps to evaluate ourselves. We are not shying away from taking the challenges ourselves, commit to make the resources available to prepare this task, build the capacities so that our developmental agenda truly becomes transformational and inclusive and developmental. With those concluding remarks, I want to take this opportunity to ask my panelists for their excellent contributions, and I want to ask you, the audience, for your excellent contributions and for staying with us in the graveyard session, that is after lunch before the reception. I want to thank the hosts for having accommodated us and making this very interesting discussion possible. Thank you very much, and I think we are adjourned.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Chair. It was very efficient.
Je tiens à remercier le membre du panel intégration du cadre de résultats, suivi et évaluation, de la clarté de leurs exposés et les éléments de réponse aux différentes observations et questions qui ont été soulevées. Nous sommes donc à...
We have now come to the end of the program slated for today. The Secretariat has informed us that there is a reception, a cocktail for all participants in the banquet hall. This will give us an opportunity to continue a conversation on this very important topic. There are some guides outside the hall to lead us to the banquet hall. Enjoy your evening. Goodbye.